Teacher's Coffee with George Kokolas and Virginia Dooley.
One more episode is about to start. Teacher's Coffee, we have reached the middle season. Welcome, Gina. Hello.
Hello. Hello, George. Thank you for welcoming me. Yes, another episode, another coffee. Mine is nice and warm and ready to have this discussion with an excellent guest from all the way from Morocco today.
Morocco, yeah. Even though today is a very cold day, both in Morocco and here, where we are, you know, Morocco always brings this exotic, hot, and sunny places to mind. So, yeah, in the middle of winter, we have brought some of this tropical warmth here, I hope, with our guest, Abdelkrim El Koubaa from Morocco. A prominent figure, an ELT trainer, and somebody who is in the front line of teaching English as a foreign language in Morocco.
An inspector of English, I found out. That's the name.
Okay, yeah. The title.
The title.
Thank you very much. Thanks, Joe. Thanks, Gina. Thanks for inviting me. It's a great pleasure for me to be, to be with you. Concerning, the ELT in Morocco, it has changed a lot, you know, from the past, you know. Now you have more and more students learning English in all
whether they are
private or they are public schools. And there is a great eagerness on the part of students to learn English. We have a huge number of language centers where students can learn English as well, you know. For the total number of students learning English, I have no idea, but it must be huge because now you have English, not like before. It used to be taught only in the high school. Now English is taught in high school, in the middle school, and in private schools, in the primary schools. Okay, but for the public schools, English is taught only now in high school and the last year of the middle school. But in the coming years, next year, inshallah, it will be taught in the middle school. Okay. Moreover, there is a change because the government, the policy of the state, they want to switch from French to English. Scientific subjects like math, science, physics, etc. Okay.
Okay. So right now, if I understood correctly, French used to be the first foreign language taught, and now English is advancing in a way, is becoming more and more popular. And I think, you know, that there is also a difference between the spoken Arabic and Moroccan Arabic. Is that true?
Yes.
So it seems like you are a trilingual nation there, right?
You are right. George, yes, there is a big difference between classical Arabic and Moroccan Arabic. Okay, thank you.
Okay.
Wonderful.
Concerning the number of teachers of English we have so far in public schools, we have more than 9,000 teachers. And when you say public schools, if you like, maybe 30 or 35% of them, they work as part-time teachers in private schools. They work in public schools and part-timers in private schools, and the number of supervisors, maybe for me it's a small number. It's 97 supervisor of English, which makes 110 teachers for one supervisor so far. Okay, and what makes English language, if you like a language which is liked a lot in Morocco and many people like to learn it, is that it's not like before. As I remember before, teachers, they used to teach English only as a subject like the other subjects. No, the tendency has changed a lot. English now is taught for other purposes, like people they need it after they graduate, you know.
Yes, we will reach that point, and maybe you can tell us more about. Before we reach that, you talked about an increased number of teachers and many students as well. The need, as we said, and the demand has grown a lot. But my next question is, do you feel that teachers today in Morocco, they have sufficient training on teaching methodology, on how to teach inside the classroom?
That's a good question. Because the job of the supervisor is to organize, if you like, sessions of training for teachers, both in public and private schools. But it depends, you know, in some areas it's enough, in others it's not enough. Like as I said, in Casablanca, Rabat, and big cities, it's enough because you have a lot of system trainings, etc. You have a lot of sessions of demo lessons, model lessons, etc. But when it comes to, if you like, small cities, etc., maybe sometimes it's difficult to organize them. You know, you see what I mean?
Okay. Absolutely. Absolutely.
It's okay. Thank you. And by the way, you have very highly qualified supervisors of English. This year, the ministry is, if you like, is training 10 more supervisors for next year, inshallah. Okay.
Okay.
Great.
So what's the, you know, now there is the switch, as you said, from French to English in the Moroccan market. But what's the goal of the English programs that take place in Morocco? Is it for the students to get a certificate to prove their language? Or is it for them to actually be able to use and communicate and speak the language? What do you see from your experience? What is the preferred, let's say?
For me, Gina, it's both. It's just it's a certificate and so that they can use it. But they can use it, if you like, it's the primary goal, is using in the future. Because now we have students when they graduate, if you like, from the university. When they go to work, they need English, you know. Okay, irrespective of their, if you like, disciplinary they have chosen, you know. Okay, I'll give you something. Last month there was a fair in a hotel in Casablanca for hiring people, and they wanted engineers. And when, if you like, the candidates they go, the first thing they ask them is English. If they find the English is good, they ask them for other things. If they find that English is not good, they say sorry, we cannot, if I hire you. You know, therefore, English now is a must. Okay. It's a privilege for, if you like, students to speak English, and for candidates who want to work in, if you like, especially now in offshore in Casablanca. You know.
This is, I think, it's a great realization in a way, and I think it's a very nice message to send out to the world, because we've been asking all these questions because we want to see how much the demand from, let's say, the market or the demand after graduation may influence teaching. And I'm saying that because in many countries, that's why Gina talked about certificates. The whole teaching of English is around acquiring a certificate. But what you are saying right now, I think this is really precious information. It looks like the market or professional careers, they demand not just for you to have a certificate or simply declare that you know English. You have to speak English. You have to be able to communicate, because you have just confirmed that if you don't speak, you're not getting the job.
Yes, you are right. Yes. The main focus is on communication, you know, and fluency. You know, this is what they want, you know. Okay. Mm-hmm.
So this brings me to the previous question as well. All this training and all these supervisors, do they focus more on how to teach communicative English inside the classrooms, or do they focus more on what is traditional, let's say, passive knowledge, exercises?
Really, it's a very good question. I was going to talk about that. In the past, supervisors, they used, if you like, to give training sessions on, if you like, teaching of language, like how to teach grammar, how to teach vocabulary, how to teach this. Now they focus more on how to be communicative, you know, okay, the purpose of English, okay, the use of English, not only how to, you know, and even the, if you like, teaching of English has switched from teaching just English as a language, and now they are trying to teach English as a tool for communication, okay?
See? Absolutely, absolutely. And sometimes, you know, this is, this can be a great challenge and a new challenge for teachers as well, because We're talking about hard work here. If you want to get a non-native speaker to speak, communicate effectively, and be a successful professional, it's a maybe an unknown path for many teachers as well, and there is nothing embarrassing in admitting that. It's not an easy task. But it's really, really great that we find out this new from you, that all this training is channeled towards this specific direction.
Absolutely. Like, I'm glad to hear that, you know, English, the teaching of it is focused for the use of communication and as a tool, as Mr. Abdelkrim said very nicely. Because at the end of the day, it's the most important thing to know how to use the language effectively and to communicate. And I think from what we've been hearing, Morocco has made great steps to improve and to make this possible by switching, also by introducing the latest methodologies. So that's amazing, really. My question is there anything else that you suggest that could be done to improve teaching English in Morocco?
Yes, Gina, yes. To improve teaching English in Morocco, schools, they should be encouraged to use, if you like, interactive whiteboards. It's very, very important in teaching English, okay? And especially if you want to achieve the goal of communication. I have noticed that the schools using IW, the students learn more. They learn more, they learn quickly than the others, you know? And it motivates students to learn more, you know. You know, the social media, etc. You know, students, they are, if you like, used to image and sound, not the traditional way of teaching, okay?
It's interactive. It makes the lesson more interactive.
Yes. Exactly. And what is good is that the books they use now, they are all interactive books, which is good. That's why they appreciate the books we recommend for them. Because it corresponds, if you like, to the need of using, if you like, English in the real situation. Okay.
Mm-hmm. And I think, you know, I don't know how this will sound, but, you know, we've been receiving at Express Publishing as well daily positive feedback for our own interactive materials as well, because all the titles are supported by the interactive whiteboard software. For many, many years now, it has been...
This is the main strength of power, if you like, the point of strength of Express Publishing.
Absolutely. It's pioneering technology and it continues, you know, to provide these high quality standards. One more question that has to do, we talked about the training and I talked about the teachers. Obviously, you may have answered it in a way, but I want to know if there is any kind of specific demand from the students regarding their needs, if the students themselves do actually want these communicative objectives, or are they still seeing English as another assignment in the curriculum, another subject in the curriculum? If you could get into your students' minds, what do you think is their views regarding the lesson of English or English as a lesson? Or how they're going to use it after that, after school?
From what I notice, from what I see in our students, I believe they believe that they use English for communication, not just a subject, you know, okay? And to prove that, many students, you know, they spend a day at school, and in the evening they go to center language to learn English for speaking, for communicating, you know, okay? This is what they want in general. They are aware that English should be used communicatively, should be used in everyday life, you know, should you use for specific purposes too, you know, okay.
That's great news, actually. That's great news.
Good.
And
I think we've reached the roast question, the surprise question of the interview. Great, okay. So... very, very interesting, very serious. So we're going to switch it up a little bit. I'm going to ask you, during your experience as an inspector of English or an ELT supervisor, what is the funniest question you have been asked by a teacher or a student?
Maybe a funny incident that you came across during your career?
I have many funny incidents. I don't call them funny, but it's something which stuck in my mind forever. Mm-hmm. When I started supervising, because me, I was a teacher too. I spent 7 years as a teacher mm-hmm. of English. Mm-hmm. And my first year of English, I was at the time about 31 of age or so. And I used to have teachers older than me. And uh-huh. sometimes it was, if you like, I was embarrassed, you know, to supervise a teacher. Mm-hmm. One of them, he was my teacher, for instance. during my first year of experience, I attended a lesson of a teacher. He was good in teaching. Everything was good. But he had a big problem in pronunciation. And he mispronounced productive words. I mean, productive. He taught words wrong to the students. And when I was discussing with him, I was ashamed to tell him that it was a mistake, etc., you know?
Yeah.
And I was surprised, you know? He's a good teacher, good in the way of teaching, it was good. And for instance, I give an example, he taught for the students for the first year, instead of saying no, they say news. And when I was discussing, I couldn't say it to him, you know?
Yeah.
And I had to write a report. At the time, we used to write reports in French. Mm-hmm. And I wrote what was positive in the lesson. It was good, good, so good. Then I write a report. I give you the word, the French sentence I wrote at the time. And I will translate it in English. I wrote, cependant, j'attire l'attention de monsieur le professeur de faire très attention aux fautes de prononciation commises par les élèves. You understand it, no?
More or less. Maybe okay.
The les élèves part, I didn't.
They're right. However, I would like to ask the teacher to pay great attention to pronunciation mistakes, okay, made by students, not teacher.
Oh, okay.
And when he read the report, he made me tell the teacher, sir, it's not, it's me. I told him, I know, it's you, it's not the students. But in the report, you know, the headmaster can read it in French, you know. Mm-hmm. You know, someone can read it, and it's not good to write by the teacher.
Okay? Yeah, absolutely.
At the time, you have no internet, you don't have, you know, you should check in the dictionary for, if you like, the transcription of the words, etc., phonetics, etc., you know. I have a lot of experiences like that, you know. Some of them are funny, you know. Okay.
That was a nice diplomatic way to get the message across. Yeah.
Yeah, very diplomatic.
Thank you.
Okay, Mr. Abdelkrim, thank you so much. I think you gave us a whole new perspective regarding English language teaching in Morocco, because we've been following developments there, and they are very, very encouraging. That, you know, you focus on communication and what
communication, that's it. Yes. Training, etc. This is the main point. Thank you very much. Thank you, Gina. Thank you, George. Really, I enjoyed, if you like doing this interview with you. It was a great pleasure for me. Thanks.
Lovely. We enjoyed it too. Have a lovely day.
Thank you.
In warm Morocco.
It's sunny now. It's really sunny.